Hi everyone, Sarah Powell again. I wanted to talk with you today about performance in times of stress and crisis. I almost had team performance here. Team performance is really important, but this also applies to individual performance. So I think that we can think about both as we go through this material. If you haven't seen my previous webinar on stress and its effects on the brain, I think you should watch that first because it'll help you understand where I'm coming from today. So once again, introducing myself, my background is in medical anthropology and public health preparedness. And for the last 5.5 years, I've been working in emergency management. So first question is, why bother thinking about how our teams perform in stress? What's the point? One thing I really like to emphasize is that this actually provides a tactical and strategic advantage to your company or to you as a leader. The tactical advantage is that you understand how people function, and the strategic advantage is maybe you're implementing things that no one else is actually working on. Operational psychology is the use of clinical, cognitive, and social concepts for their tactical and operational value. The point here is that we are human beings. We have limitations. We're not robots. And so understanding what those psychological perks and detractors are can really help us have a better strategic advantage. So these things apply to all kinds of fields: culture, management, operations, how we do our work in many different ways. And it really helps us understand human behavior. Remember from our previous webinar that behavior is a function of the person and the environment. What are we asking our people to do? We have all kinds of security operators, nurses, knowledge workers, any kind of thoughtful, intensive job, especially a job working in a crisis environment. These are the kinds of job functions we're asking people to do during a crisis. Multitasking, which I can't wait to talk about in a later webinar. Distilling information, synthesizing data, quickly analyzing problems. All of these functions rely on your prefrontal cortex and a really high dose of your cognitive function. So let's think about this right now in the context of the global pandemic of COVID-19. What are we asking our folks to be able to do when they need to be able to pull on that cognitive function? What's the environment that they're in? What are the conditions that they're facing, and how much stress are they facing? So Yerkes-Dodson's law is an empirical relationship between arousal and performance. Note that this was developed in 1908. We have known this for over 100 years. You can see there in the curve that initially you have a low level of arousal and your performance is going to be weak. So that stress arousal response, right? The more you have that physiological reaction of readiness, as it increases, you increase your attention and interest and your performance goes up. So I used to be a fencer. When I was going out to have a bout, I would have sort of a heightened level of stress, but it would focus my attention. I would be better. My performance would be better because of a little bit of that stress response. But as you can see there, there's an optimal point, and after that, performance starts to decline. One thing we've learned from research is that the more an experience is novel, unpredictable, or there's a perception that it's not controllable, the worse people's performance is going to be. So we have to think creatively about how we create conditions through exercise and training and other practices to make sure that when people are facing some kind of unusual circumstance, that they've been prepared at least somewhat so that they have some confidence. Now, stress inoculation training is a methodology used in VIP security protection, in Navy SEALs and other kinds of high-performing military personnel. Stress inoculation training is a way to help people achieve a level of confidence in the response that they're undertaking in a stressful environment. So they're actually put in the stressful environment, but they're set up to succeed so that they develop that confidence. that contact with what kinds of stressors they may face, and also a sense of their own familiarity with what some of these circumstances might feel like. This is why exercises, and I'm talking about all kinds of exercises, from tabletop exercises to functional exercises and training scenarios, are so critical to anyone who's going to be operating in a crisis. Stress inoculation training does help performance. As you can see there, it bumps up your ability to have more stress and still higher performance, but there's still a tipping point. There's still a decline that will happen to anyone, even the best trained people. So what can we do to mimic this effect? We need to think about having that positive mindset, a success-oriented mindset, and being able to make decisive actions in crisis conditions. We can provide this for our teams as well, and we can enhance their environment so that they feel that they're a team, they're working together, and they're going to be successful. Let's talk about some solutions. First off, I really, really encourage you to examine the culture that you have created or that you're working in right now. For example, we don't want to get hung up on this idea of this is just the way we do things around here, because in a crisis, that can be the death knell. The Columbia crash from NASA in the 80s is a perfect example of NASA being hung up on the way we do things around here to the detriment of the lives of people who died in that accident. We don't want to underestimate the importance of positive morale. If people don't feel like they're going to be successful, or that they trust the leadership, or that people have their backs, it will absolutely deteriorate their performance. And we don't want to underestimate the importance of strong leadership. At this point, we need leaders to provide guidance, even in times of tremendous uncertainty. I should really say, especially in times of tremendous uncertainty, we need to have some clear direction, even if we have to pivot at a later point. One thing that's super interesting about organizational culture is that it really can affect the attitude of our teams, which is a cognitive affective state. Is it positive? Is it negative? So let's say we have a stressor of some kind. This cognitive affective state actually buffers or increases the vulnerability that leads to turnover, job dissatisfaction, illness, and burnout. And what this means is that if your teams have a positive morale, it actually mediates their ability to manage the stressor itself, which is really interesting. So I just want you to picture right now, if you're working in a nursing team for a hospital, or in a security team on the ground, and the culture is really positive and success oriented, you're actually going to see less illness and burnout. You're going to see people do better. It actually has a very powerful measure of success in terms of influencing this cognitive affective domain when you're talking about trying to mitigate against burnout and turnover, job dissatisfaction, and so forth. You're also going to see a higher level of performance. So the second tip I want to give you is to really think about, how do we reduce that cognitive load on our teams? If we use protocols and written SOPs, or standard operating procedures, checklists, decision trees, swim lane diagrams, process diagrams, we're creating the condition where in a crisis situation, I don't have to think so hard. I'm not trying to dredge up what to do for my memory. As an emergency manager, I can tell you that my kind of approach to preparedness is that in a crisis situation, I don't really want to have to think, because I know it's going to be harder for me to think. I would rather be able to say, okay, I got this. I can look at my checklist and make sure I'm not forgetting anything that needs to be done. Cannot be underestimated how powerful these tools can be and how helpful, especially if we've run through them before and they become familiar to us. We want to minimize frustration. So by all means, use technology Make sure you have clear reporting structures and use project management solutions if you have access to them. There's some free software out there that makes project management way easier, and you don't even need to really pay for it, or you can pay a small amount for it and have tremendous benefits. The third thing is that I want you to think of yourself, if you are a manager or if you manage any kind of team, as the architect, thinking about operational stress and building in stress controls to whatever structures you have. Be proactive about this ahead of time. Rule number one is you need to communicate with your folks about what you're doing, and you need to communicate with your folks about what action steps should be taken. A tenet of risk communication is simply that: be clear, tell people what's going on. Make sure you're giving them things that they can do to take care of themselves and others. And make sure people understand very clearly what the plan is. There's nothing worse than sort of just hoping people don't notice, or, you know, not being clear about what's going on. These are exactly the kinds of things that will tank your team's morale and will tank their belief in you as a manager or a leader. Rule number two is you need to have a clear organizational structure. There's nothing worse than people having to report to two bosses or not knowing how to move and what to do because they're not sure where they fit in the organizational structure. Having dotted lines to multiple bosses is just not effective, and it's not efficient, and it really creates frustrations for your staff. Three, you must share this responsibility for promoting a healthy work environment. I think a lot of times people sort of put it on their staff to enact wellness efforts or self-care, where there's sort of like people need to know how to take care of themselves. Sure, but you can also do a lot to reduce the stress load on your teams and to make sure you are working to promote that healthy work environment. I will definitely be getting into this, some of the common pitfalls and how this might fail if you don't do steps to promote a healthy work environment in my next webinar. I think it's going to be a really important thing for you to understand the things that can go wrong when you don't build in operational stress controls early on. Number four, you know what your people are going through. You can anticipate stressors. So face the reality of what they may face and build these responses ahead of time rather than just waiting for it to happen or ignoring that it might happen. In the time of COVID-19, it may be, what do we do when one person gets sick, when two people get sick, when five people get sick? What do we do when we lose some of our team? How do we build in controls to anticipate these stressors? What do we do when some of our team's family members get sick? You know, how do we manage this situation so that we're keeping morale up, we're providing clear risk communication and crisis communications externally, and we're prepared to meet the demands? So as always, I'm going to provide you with a sheet of takeaways because I don't want you to forget these ideas. And hopefully you'll be able to use this and implement these ideas for your own team, for yourself, for others. Thank you so much. Please feel free to contact me on LinkedIn if you enjoyed this webinar. And I really hope to see you for our third installment.